good to see everyone. As we get settled here, I think that this panel follows well Larry's remarks, because in many ways the observations about the role of philanthropy in building a vibrant society, strengthening capitalism, strengthening the democracy, I think kind of lays the groundwork for a conversation with three leaders who, through different sets of experiences, are experimenting with the role of philanthropy in India and the role of philanthropy more broadly. And so I'm really delighted and feel privileged to get to spend the next hour with these leaders. And what we're going to do is go from kind of the big framing picture of the role of philanthropy in its role in democracy to the personal stories of three individuals that are doing, if you will, doing philanthropy in various ways. And what we're going to do is hear a little bit from each of them. We'll have a brief conversation up here, and then we're going to open it up. So as you're listening, please kind of think about what it is that sparked for you a question, an observation about what they're doing and what you're doing. And so what I've asked the three to do to start with is each take about 5 minutes in simply one, give us a brief picture of how they started in philanthropy, kind of where did that impulse come from, and then, this is going to be a lot in 5 minutes, but we're going to see if this works, and then to pick one exciting example of something they're doing and what they've learned from it in the realm of philanthropy. So we're going to go from kind of the beginning to then fast forward to just one example just to kind of get some grist for the conversation, and then we'll take it from there in a conversation up here and then open it up. So Ram, maybe we could start with you.
Okay, thank you. Good morning, everyone. So my story on philanthropy is I grew up in Chennai, India in the 1960s and 70s. My father died when I was only 3, and my mother went back to college, so we moved back in with my grandparents. And we were a middle-class family, but my grandparents had this little school, which we today know to be a K-12 school, but in a town called Tambaram, which is about, it's now part of Greater Chennai because the city has grown so much. It's not too far from the airport. And they started it with about 40 kids back in the 1940s, and that continued to grow. So in the 1960s, when I was a little kid, I used to go with him to the school because they depended very heavily on donations from parents who themselves were poor but who aspired to send their kids to school. And so he would be there pretty much on the weekends but also sometimes after work on the weekdays, meeting, recruiting teachers, working with the school leadership. And it was a small school. It was about 200 students at the time. Today that school, and my grandfather passed away in 1982, today that school has 15,000 students and it's actually supported by the state. But this is an example of learning philanthropy at the feet of someone who you admire. So one day when I was maybe about 11 years old, I asked him, why do you do this? And he said, I do it because I want to leave a legacy. I want to work with somebody who I don't know, who's not part of my family, who are complete strangers to me, and who I believe whose life and trajectory I can change in some way. And to me, that was a very meaningful statement. And he also said, well, my basic needs are met. We were middle class. We were not very wealthy. And we actually moved from the town of Tambaram to Chennai so that I could go to school. So his hometown was Tambaram, so he wanted to do something where he had impact in his place where he had grown up, and what a great legacy he left behind. So that was where I had my philanthropy gene, if you will, turned on. And it taught me that you don't have to be old to give. It also taught me that you don't have to have a lot of money to give. You can do your own meaningful contribution either in the form of money or time. In fact, sweat equity is frequently a lot harder than money. And it was a wonderful sort of learning experience, and it came with no agendas, and he turned out to be the greatest mentor for my philanthropy.
And if you could, that's great, Rama. If you could give just one example of something you're doing now that is kind of exciting and that you've learned something from recently.
Yeah. So fast forward to the late 90s, I was fortunate to be in a whole bunch of successful internet companies. So I started investing in India, maybe a little too early because those companies haven't been as successful as perhaps, at least on a funding basis, the current crop of internet ventures. But one of them was this company called ClearTrip, and one of the founders of that was this young man, Matthew Space, who is actually a Brit, originally from the UK, married an Indian woman and decided to live in Mumbai. And when the company was successfully exiting to a US company called Concur, bought them, he made a little money. And I said, what are you going to do next? And he said, well, my passion is philanthropy. I'm going to take my winnings and go invest it in the street kids that I play soccer with right outside my high rise. Because as you know, in Mumbai, there's the high rises and right below it are the shanty towns and where the people live. And he had built a connection with these young kids, many of whom didn't go to school. And he wanted to do something meaningful in their lives where he could actually start a nonprofit that worked on doing social good through connecting them through sports and giving them sort of basic life skills. And so I seed funded that along with his funding. And today, I think, what is it, 5-6 years later, they are supporting about 400,000 kids across India in 3 or 4 chapters and continue to raise about $5 million a year and doing a pretty nice job with mopping up at least part of the need for this type of organization to exist.
Great, thank you. And that's Magic Bus.
That's right? Correct, yes. Magic Bus.
Just want to make sure they get their name out there because it's a very impressive organization. Let me turn to Peter, and Peter has kind of two. There, he'll begin with one role, but I think it's worth mentioning because I'm sure this will come up. Both he's the co-founder of the Kiowa Trust and doing a lot of work in India. He's also the chairman of Atlantic Philanthropies, which is the largest spend down institution in history, and so there's some lessons learned from that experience too. So let me start with kind of where your philanthropic gene got turned on, and just one example that we might start with of something that's exciting that you're working on.
Thanks very much, Jeff. Rachita, can you hear me? A couple of weeks ago, I asked that question, and the person responded, "I'd be really happy to change places with anyone that can't." It sort of pauses and makes you think. Let me start at the very, very beginning. I grew up in South Wales. I grew up in a community which was about steel and coal. This was 3 years before the end of the war. Where I grew up had been completely bombed flat. So our house was the only house literally in the street that was still standing. Unemployment was very, very high. So my recollection of my early life, my father didn't work. It was a community where nobody went to university. They didn't even go to what you would consider, if you like, a good school. They would be local community schools. So a very, very poor area. Lynn and I had a conversation currently, a little while ago, and the guy we were talking to said, I was poor. And then he explained that his father had been a captain of a ship in the Royal Navy, and he'd gone to the most expensive school in the UK. So there's interesting sort of definitions of what poverty actually means. So I literally started with nothing. I went into the cooperative movement after university, which is all about quality of teachers. And I literally wrote essays on politics about how labor should be organized. So that was very much my background. And then with a big flip and change in career, I went into electronics and then into private equity and started a firm for people. And today there's 250 people in 14 offices. So that was sort of like the career. When we got to the point of making some money, so the question about then what you do with it and whether you believe in philanthropy and whether you believe that there is a responsibility within a capitalistic society to help people, I absolutely believe that. Lynn absolutely believes it, and so do our children. So it then became an issue of how do you help? So the commitment to help, we'd made some money. We saw lots of poverty the way that we grew up. So then there's the question of how you apply it. And our approach to philanthropy has been very much our approach to investing. It's a very rational approach. It talks about research. It talks about evidence. It talks about monitoring. It talks about what you get for your money. So that approach is very much private equity. It's very much the approach of Atlantic Philanthropies, the guy who started Atlantic Philanthropies, which has now almost given away $9 billion. The guy who started that, Chuck Feeney, literally will still say to me, and what will I get for my money? So it's his approach hasn't changed at all. He's a slightly quirky, cantankerous man, but incredibly demanding and incredibly caring to look after other people. So I brought together a number of different events. I've been at Atlantic for 13 years, and I've been chairing Atlantic for the last 4 years. A wonderful experience. I mean, absolutely amazing, but that's not for today, because India's not part of it. When I think about events that really stand out in my mind, we'd already made the decision with our family money to move to India. So that decision was taken. We'd already decided that adolescent girls would be the focus of any programs. But we were also acutely aware of just how little we knew about the culture. And one of the things I have learned many, many times at Atlantic is transferring methods from one culture to another often doesn't work. I love the expression, culture eats strategy. So when you really think you're smart and then you try it in a different environment and you realize it just doesn't work. So we have a week with Deval and Paksan, who's here somewhere. Where is she?
She's there.
Not even sitting down. Which was a fantastic week. And then we had a week with Neera and a guy called Vishal, who I don't think is here, or if he is, I've not seen him. And we visited organizations in India. It was the poorest parts of India and also the most disadvantaged communities and villages in India. So it really is sort of shocking and disturbing, and you think you're really used to it, but you're not. And just realizing how similar the philosophy that we had, and I explained some of it came from investing, some of it came from Atlantic, but how close we were to DASRA. They really believe in research, and it's good quality research. They do believe in identifying capable organizations that really can make a difference. They really do stay close to those organizations and help them develop the model, which is very much private equity model. They do care about the impact, and they measure the impact exactly like Atlantic would. So to get money out of Atlantic is tough, and then you get lots of questions post getting the money. And DASRA, through Neera and Deval, kept bringing out this. And we finished with this complete association. So it was about partnership. It was similarities of approach. It was similarities of value. And then we started to explore, why couldn't we have a sector within DASRA that focused on adolescent girls? Because one of the messages that come out to me so clearly in my work in philanthropy, you have to engage the heart. You have to find things that people really, really care about. I was on the board of an organization called NPC. And what NPC does is sell efficiency. And there's lots of organizations that sell efficiency. The trouble is, most people with money don't want to buy efficiency. They want to follow their hearts, and they want to be sure that the money is used wisely. But you can't start with a product proposition which says, I'll help you use your money efficiently. So what was great, and the big message for me was, this alignment of interests. We might come back to the question of partnership and collaboration, what it actually means. But in our world, me, Lynn, our daughters, the relationship with DASRA is a match of interests. It is a match of approach. And the focus on adolescent girls, we completely agree on. So that's the example.
Great. No, thank you very much. That's terrific. So Neera, you've heard her talk a little bit about DASRA, but there's probably no place that has a better window on, in many ways, what's happening in philanthropy, how are people thinking about their work than DASRA and the work that you all do. I mean, I hadn't made the connection, but I mean, Peter's an example of that, Peter and Lynn. So maybe if you could start about your journey, despite your denial about kind of not really being a banker, but kind of a banker, kind of the journey yeah. into this kind of work, and then just an example that stands out for you that relates to philanthropy impact in India.
Sure. So I kept telling Jeff, I'm like, I'm the oddball here, and how are you going to make this connect? So please make it connect. But
wasn't that good?
Yeah, that was good. Thank you. everyone doesn't look like it's connected. Hello. I thought I'd break down my journey and in some sorts into sort of the three P's, the first being privilege, the second being people, and the third being sort of possibility. And I'd start with privilege by saying it's just a privilege to be here with all of you on stage, especially because where I come from or my journey is actually quite different. So I had not the most exciting upbringing, I'd say. I pretty much grew up in a regular Indian first generation, but immigrant family. I grew up in Canada, which makes it, I guess, a bit cooler now that we have this cool prime minister. But I grew up in Canada and grew up with parents who were engineers, and so I couldn't study liberal arts or anything fun like drama. It was like, my sister and I, you absolutely must study science and engineering. My sister was really smart, so she went to MIT. And I wasn't as smart, but I could do math. So I was like, okay, can I do math? And they were like, fine. What profession in math? Actuarial science. I'm not sure why. And so I was going to be an actuary for most of my life in undergrad, and then figured out that there was this thing called business. And you go to class, and you read a case, and you put your hand up, and 60% of your grade is participation. I was like, wow. This is much easier than sort of the theory of interest stuff from first principles that I was learning in class. So studied math and ended up in a boom, graduating in a boom market. I thought there was something special about me, but basically got recruited into the investment banking side when the analyst program was sort of at its prime. And I chose Morgan Stanley and went to work in mergers and acquisitions. I thought I was really cool in New York City. And I didn't think about really changing the world at that point whatsoever. I just thought it was really great to be making six figures, more than my dad ever made, and my dad's here, so I won't. Well, maybe it's putting him on the spot a bit. but more than my parents made, and so I was basking in all of that glory and was following the regular track, right? You do Morgan Stanley, you went to a private equity fund, or you went to business school. And I was like, oh, everyone's going to private equity funds. Why don't I try business school? But actually, I don't really want to study. But let's just apply. So I applied and got into Harvard. And I thought, wow, they've made this big mistake. I better go. So I went there only to rack up tons of loans. But I would say through the experience between Morgan Stanley and business school, my mom actually moved back to India and opened up a school for tribal children on campus, Indian Institute of Technology, her alma mater and my father's alma mater. And they started a school for tribal Adivasi kids to have access to better quality education. And in retrospect, I realized I think that was sort of playing on my mind. But I was very much, I want to get a job and I want to be able to make money, because that was sort of my world at that point. But honestly, believe it or not, and many won't probably, I was brainwashed at business school. I really thought was brainwashed in their whole, you are a leader of tomorrow, and you know, you will make a difference. And Warren Buffett's opening lines was, you know, you must make a difference in the world. And I was like, okay, I gotta make a difference, And so graduated from school and went back into banking. but I think it was there where I realized how privileged I had been with all of the education that I had and all of the exposure that I had to the business school. I all of a sudden realized that there was a role that I could play in bridging sort of two sides, being able to be on the ground and see the school and see communities and what they needed, and being able to translate that to a group that really wanted to make a difference. And being that catalyst is really the premise with which what we sort of started Dasra. And I think the motivation from the privilege came sort of the people. And if I can even highlight some of the leaders in this audience that we've brought from India, you know, they continue to inspire me. So we have Saparna. Can you wave, Saparna? From the Angan Trust. We have Kathy here from EcoFem. We have Pratima from Shelter. You know, these are individuals for whom I think Dasra was created, and it's honestly these people for whom, you know, we continue to work. Am I going on too long?
No, that's great.
Okay. The last one was possibility. and I think that for most of us on stage, I believe that we're all living in a world with sort of glass half full. And so I think what's very exciting about India is the scale and the complexity and the possibility of how many people we can influence. And I think that's really what motivates me.
That's great, thank you. So I'll ask a few questions and then we'll open it up. The first one is around focus. And I'm curious, Ram, the decision, as we heard in this morning, kind of with some of the opening remarks, just the breadth of issues one could tackle leaves open this question of where do you begin? What is it that led you to focus on Magic Bus? Is it picking an organization, or was it an issue? And then I'll ask Peter, you the same thing, because I think that's one of the questions in terms of people getting started, getting deeper. How did you decide where to really play?
Yeah, the choice on Magic Bus wasn't very profound. It was somebody I knew, and I was making a choice on a human being that I knew was dedicated, committed, not even so much on the mark, on the space. Although on the space question, I would say that our focus has been in education. We did try briefly clean water, and the best way to do these things is to do a pilot and then see if it works. And if it doesn't work, you cut your losses and move on. And in our case, our experience, since I think Radhika brought up talk about failures, for us the failure was clean water, although I know there are other successes out there in India. And the reason it failed was it was just too daunting a task. I think the whole clean water initiative depends on a bunch of things. It depends on personal hygiene and the education around personal hygiene. It depends on having electricity in the village or town that you're trying to do this in. It depends on having an RO plant that you can keep up and running and having enough volunteers to do that, making sure the UV filters are there and they're working. And lastly, making sure that the people you're serving understand that previously they didn't have clean water and now they have clean water and then they don't misuse it. So you have to figure out a way to make that economic model work so that it's not completely free. But anyway, we decided to give up on it because it was just not something that we could see a clean, easy way to do and execute on the ground. And that was a few $100,000 later. We said, well, we're going to halt. It seemed like a good, big, hairy, audacious goal to have, but then it was hard to execute on the ground. Education, I think, has been a wonderful journey for us, and not the least because I learned with my grandfather and the way he scaled that little school that became this big school, but also because I could see a near-term return on education. And again, we focus on the girl child. I think over 50% of Magic Buses. Young women who are, and they mostly take kids between the ages of 5 and 16 into the program, so they've largely focused on that segment. And it's one where you know that they are going to turn out to be far more responsible, nothing against men in the audience here. But they, in India at least, the experience has been that they are more likely to be the anchor for the family, to be involved in trying to make sure that they're able to then perhaps aspire to go to college and so on. So that has been at least telling in the cohort group of the first 6-7 years of the program. And so there's enough data, enough evidence that that actually works. Now the thing I would say on scale is that I would say quality before scale. In fact, I think one of our concerns is Magic Bus has been growing a little too quickly. We've opened far too many new chapters, and it would be better to actually focus in on a few areas and do a good job with fewer people. Even though the demand and the need is great, I would rather focus on, you know, at the end of the day, philanthropy is deeply personal. It's also about having, experiencing the journey of that individual, maybe living in their shoes and understanding how it's going to change their life. And to the extent you do a good job with a fewer number of people, you're better off than trying to aim broad and not do such a good job with it.
One quick question, Ram. Your example of failure, I'm just struck by being in Silicon Valley where it seems like there's just this, you know, hero worship of the failures, like, you know, it's people's resumes, I failed 10 times and like, hire me. Like, I mean, I'm slightly overstating it, but I'm curious if in philanthropy that, if your experience of, if you will, and in failure, I mean, that story of failure is learning and there was impact in the midst of doing it. So I want, that word is a complicated word, but I'm just curious, is there a difference between, if you will, failing in the business world in kind of the kind of work you do and failing in philanthropy?
Yeah, good question. Well, in the business world, I wouldn't fail 10 times. If you are failing 10 times, I'd say go work in a big company. You're not cut out to be an entrepreneur. Maybe up to 3 failures, I'd say, is a badge of honor, and they cannot be 3 consecutive failures.
But quite precise.
Yes. Because I live this world quite a bit. In the world of philanthropy, I think you have to be much more tolerant of failure, because I think what you're looking at is it's return on impact. It's not return. Well, it is return on the dollar, but it sometimes takes longer to get return on the ground, and you have to be patient with your dollar. And if you're too impatient and you're looking for too rapid a return, sometimes you sort of miss the opportunity to actually grow that effort into something meaningful. And I do think that the people that start that NGO matter a lot. So, and passion is an overused word, but I do think it's an underused word in with respect to philanthropy. You have to be deeply committed to the task at hand, because you don't have somebody saying, "Oh, great, good job," every morning when you come into work. You know, what really spurs you on is the people that you're serving, the end beneficiary. So I really focus on organizations that focus on the end beneficiary versus organizations that do a lot of analysis and don't quite focus on the end beneficiary. They end up doing a great job for the people that become fellows in their program, and not so much. So they turn out a lot of people who are young and impressionable who become perhaps philanthropists later in their life, but they don't necessarily focus on end beneficiary. I'm not going to name organizations here, but I have several in mind that are quite large and quite successful, but they don't actually do a good job with end beneficiary. So that's my focus.
Right. Peter, either on focus or failure, kind of?
Had them both. We've spent a lot of time over the last 30 years choosing management teams, and we back them from buying companies like Hugo Boss down to small companies at the early stage. And what strikes me is passion and energy. You never see successful people, they're not successful for long, without demonstrating passion and energy. But also this big need for focus, because without being focused, you can't decide what it is you have to do well. So I think about passion and energy, and I think about focus and competence. So when we started to talk about chapter 2 with the Kiowa Trust, our family money, we were very explicit in that we would limit the geography, and we would limit the causes, and we would limit the intervention. So that was going to be focus. The decision to go to India has lots of parts to it. But a big part is a disaffection with colonialism, with what the UK left around the world, because a lot of what they left wasn't good. So when you think about partition in India, finished up with 12 million people moving home, which is effectively like extraditing all of the undocumented immigrants that you currently have in the US. So try and picture that. Now, when I say this in the UK, people say to me, "Are you anti-British?" And I say, "No, I'm not anti-British. I'm anti-colonialism, and I'm anti what left." So there's one set of motivations. Lynn's going to talk for herself in a moment. I'm working in San Diego. Lynn has gone to Chennai. She's been working with rag pickers in slums with an organization called Nalam Dana, which is street theater. So it's a convergence of lots of different themes. So we knew we were going to be geographically limited. We knew that we would choose a cause. We knew it would not be in the UK. We knew it would be X Commonwealth, X British Empire. The advantages of that is they speak English, which means we understand more quickly, which is important for our mindset. It would have an English-type legal system, which we would both understand, and we'd have a much better idea about how to be effective in that environment. Because if we can't be effective, we don't want to play the game. So it's very, very clear for us whether that's the need to win, but it certainly is the need to make a difference. And part of that is reflected in style. So we like to go and see. We like to be involved. Big advantage with DASRA, we actually get consulted. We're part of it. The partnership in DASRA is with USAID, it is with Piramal, it is with the Kiowa Trust. So focus, big issue. Why girls? For all the reasons you just said, they're the most sensible half of the relationship.
Twitter's just going to be a, you know, kind of buzzing with these very neat little quotes.
But they do. You know, they do more with their money. They do put it, more goes back into the family. So if you're thinking about leverage, if you want to think about minimum input to create maximum output, why wouldn't you choose girls? So that's part of it. The other part of it, and you heard me say earlier, I've had 14 years in Atlantic Philanthropies, and so many disadvantaged groups. So I've spent a lot of time in Northern Ireland looking at Protestants and Catholics, a lot of time in South Africa looking at agricultural workers, time in Vietnam with the health differences, health outcome differences with the different populations. So we really have seen disadvantage. And Atlantic's philosophy is to change the lives of the vulnerable and the disadvantaged. I cannot think of a more disadvantaged group. And give me the benefit of the doubt, I've read about a lot. Adolescent girls in India are literally in a class of their own, and it's not a good class to be in. So we found the necessity to try and do something there and make a difference to be incredibly compelling. So I gave you why India, and I'm saying why girls in India, because they are the most disadvantaged in a disadvantaged country and one of the most disadvantaged groups in the world. People say, will you solve the problem of adolescent girls in India? Of course you won't. But can you change the lives of hundreds of thousands of girls in India? Yes, you can. Could you get to 1 million? Evidence says, yes, you can. So the ability to make a difference is there. Right focus. You can't be competent unless you know what you're focused on. And the right partners, USAID, Piramal, and DASRA. It's a great foursome.
That's great. Neera, both Ram and Peter have talked about the role, the analogies to business in kind of what can be learned and kind of what can be leveraged. In DASRA, what have you seen that actually does transfer and what doesn't transfer from the business world? Because it's used as an analogy of, like, if you really care, I mean, one stream, that's not what folks here are saying, but one stream is if you really care about results, run this thing like a business and, you know, it'll work.
Yeah.
What are the limits of that?
So I think there are quite a few limitations, but at the same time, I want to be very careful that everyone doesn't leave here thinking there's this for-profit world and then there's this non-profit world. So I do fundamentally believe there are a lot of things that are transferable, and we often don't push ourselves to extend to that. I think fundamentally the biggest difference is the ability to measure in the for-profit world is very straightforward. It's cost-driven, largely profit-driven. And on the nonprofit world, I think we're figuring out how to measure and be more results-based. And it's a lot longer before you see it and the impact that you're trying to have. So that time frame, I think, is a real challenge. And I also wanted to go back to this, a little bit of what both Ram and Peter were saying around sort of scale and focus and sort of what's the role of leadership for both of these pieces. And I feel like, you know, focus is a privilege, back to my three P's. When you start off as a nonprofit, for sure, and maybe even a for-profit to some extent, you know, you start off with a certain business model, and so I think a business model approach, as we use in the for-profit side, is very much relevant in the nonprofit. So when you've got, you know, your business model, when you're working in these communities and the feedback that you get, you have to be fairly nimble when you're starting. And so I feel there's a number of years, and you can ask Saparna, Kathy, Pratima, when you've started to build these relationships with the community, you start to focus with one intervention, and then you realize downstream or upstream, you know, you need another intervention. And so do you provide that intervention or do you stay focused? So the human element, the time lag, you know, the challenge in being able to measure all of this, I think really makes it more challenging to actually be focused. But at the same time, to be focused allows you to scale. And so there must be a point in your lifespan, I think, where we've seen organizations need to decide that they are there to scale. And that comes from the passion and energy of the leadership. So if the leadership of the organization doesn't have that intent to scale, we've seen that that is the biggest challenge, actually, to be able to achieve that. I haven't fully answered your for-profit number model, but just
I think that speaks to it and some of the differences. Let me open it up to questions, observations, and if you could just say who you are and where you're from, that would be great as you pose your question. Are here, and we have microphones coming towards you.
I'm Radhika Shah. I'm a vice president here at a group called Stanford Angels and Entrepreneurs, a tech innovation community, and started the local chapter for Ashoka, the Silicon Valley chapter. My question is about transformations that are starting to happen in philanthropy for all the panelists. One trend I see, just having been in the world of the SDGs, is there's a lot of talk of democratizing philanthropy, where the difference between the donors and the donees is kind of blurring, and getting people at every level, like Ram's story, starting to think of themselves, empowering themselves, and starting doing philanthropy, as well as this thinking of the West is helping the rest of the world, shifting that. And also in this case, young girls, agents of change, making them agents of change. Thoughts on that, and is there a role for technology in bringing that shift? And the second question again is, with the Sustainable Development Goals, where poverty is, it seems like there's just not enough money in philanthropy and government aid. Is there a role here to bring a transformational shift in the corporate world, where one can bring social mission primacy as something that complements leveraging market dynamics, make revenues, and get a significant percent of corporations to also adopt social goals? So I'd love to get your thoughts on that.
Those are two gigantic questions that you're going to bite off. So let me suggest we should start with the first one and just quickly. I want to make sure we get the chance to hear from various folks. So we'll be fairly brief in responses. But the first one about the voice of beneficiaries and kind of what role that plays, the democratization of philanthropy, the boundaries between philanthropists and those being served, the constituents. How does that play? And you mentioned, Ram, a little bit about this in your remarks.
Yeah. Well, I think at Magic Bus, we use the beneficiaries as employees later when they become mentors, when they go back into the communities they serve. And they are the most passionate ambassadors of the cause because they've actually gone through the program. And when they become mentors, they're paid mentors, so they're actually on the payroll of the nonprofit. They're able to reinforce the values and help the other kids stay in the straight and narrow, if you will, of the program and make sure they're successful so they don't drop out, et cetera. So that's a kind of our way of democratizing and helping the beneficiary. Now, a lot of beneficiaries go on to vocational programs like becoming a retail store clerk or an auto mechanic or working in a BPO or other places. But a vast number of them are employed in our own program. Mm-hmm.
Any other thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, two things. I mean, I think there's no doubt that technology is an enabler in terms of bringing voice up and being able to crowdsource of sorts in terms of voice as well as philanthropy is where things are definitely moving in India. I think that organizations are learning, especially nonprofits, on how to incorporate technology into what has not necessarily been part of their models, but you're getting great nonprofits that are just leading with that, and that is sort of their intervention. So I think we're starting to see a lot of that in India. In terms of the democratization of philanthropy, I think a big piece of what Dasra is trying to do is build indigenous philanthropy, right? It's a lot of the responsibility for making change in India should come from wealth in India. And so trying to push that to be able to take risk, to be able to scale, to be strategic, is a lot of what we're trying to do. But mind you, it's a bit slow. And so what the West is actually very useful at, and why we do these forums, is to say, look at the possibility and what people have been strategic on this side, and how do we want to define that in the context of India is a lot of what we try to do. Mind you, I do think this demographic dividend that we're going to get in India, where we're going to have a huge bulge of young people, these young people want to be engaged. They want to engage in their time. They want to engage in money. We're seeing more people giving from their salaries. And these end up collecting to be large quantum. So I do think we're going to start to see more of that in India.
Do you want to add anything?
It was a very big question. But if I just take a part of it, more and more firms are encouraging employees to play a role. So when we invest in companies, it's one of the things that we'll talk to them about. What role will they have in each of their communities? Can they identify groups that they would like to help? Are they prepared to fund any of these initiatives? Are they prepared to release their employees? Will they give them a prescribed amount of time? And I've worked in two different private equity firms. So one has been about the United States and about Europe and about Japan. And in some ways, much, much slower to get that group to move. But I've also chaired an emerging market private equity firm that was a spin out from the British government. So they had a history of loans. So that was a great and easy cultural fit. So the types of people that were employed there really did have a social conscience. They really were aware of the differences they could make. And giving them the option whether they wanted to use their time or their money. Sometimes they would have been younger and they wouldn't have had the money. So actually sort of encouraging people to come into this, yes, that happens. I'd like to go back to one of the points Neera made, which is, I think, really important. When you think about philanthropy, the challenges that you face are much, much more complicated than business challenges. So if you think about changing the lives of girls in India, which way do you do that? You know, how much is it about health? How much is it about education? How much is it about sanitation? How much is it about cultural change within the family? How much is it about changing the age of marriage? How much is it about delaying first child? So I think over the last 4 or 5 years for me, there's been quite a big swing where philanthropy is much more aware of the customer, forgive the words, but holistically. So if you take the alliance and the work that the Dasra Girl Alliance is doing with Bridgespan, a fundamental principle of that is you will treat the girl holistically. Lynn and I sat in a hut in northern India, and literally one of the girls said to us, hey, this is great. So you've educated me, and I understand now what I've got to do not to have children, and I'm going to get married later. That's all great. Can you find me a job? That was a conversation. She said it slightly more politely than that. But that was the gist of it. You have to think of me holistically. You have to think of me as a whole person. And the move from individual interventions, unless they're integrated, so unless you get a number of people to deliver different ways of changing the girl's life, it's not going to happen. So that's been the big swing for me, much more awareness in philanthropy of who the customer actually is and how you integrate the services around the customer.
Great. Let me just open it. We'll come back to the broader resource question in a minute. But let me just see if there's that kind of other questions, comments, thoughts.
My name is Madhvi Pratt. I'm a board member of an organization called Home of Hope. We're all about educating and empowering the disadvantaged child. And specifically, my program is called Educate to Empower, which is about educating the adolescent girls in villages. The question and the struggles that we face in our organization really is the mindset and the challenges we face with corporations and donors is about, you know, volunteers versus paid staff. And of course, what percentage of the donations and what percentage of the money that we get should be reserved, so to speak, for lack of a better word, should be, what percentage is considered overhead versus operating costs, and how does that fit into the values of, you know, what you would consider philanthropy and what is appropriate in your opinion?
No, that's a great question about just how you all think about kind of overhead indirect costs.
Maybe Neera.
I'm going last.
I tell people that they should read a piece of research that Bridgespan did, literally. So I don't know how many copies I've run of this, which talks about the benefit of overhead. You've got to forgive me saying this bluntly, but I really think the people that get wrapped up in that debate, that they're missing the point. Imagine you were trying to run a big business and you didn't know what was going on. You know, you didn't know where your costs were. You didn't know whether you were having an impact or not because you didn't have an impact budget and you couldn't afford to tell anybody really whether you were making a difference or not. It doesn't make sense. So we got this question in New York a little while ago. I'd love you to think about it as an objection, as a sales objection, and practice with other members that are here about how you answer that question constructively. Because you have to be able to run it. You have to be able to know what you're doing. Otherwise, you can't raise the money. So the philanthropist, on the one hand, is saying, and what is this, and what is this, and what is this? And if on the other hand, he's saying, but I'm not going to give you any money for you to work out the answers to these questions, there's a massive contradiction. Think about it as an objection and have multiple practices to handle the answer. You've got to have the money to run your foundation properly. You've got to know what's going on.
And I think it's fair, let me add one thing and just highlight one interesting thing that just came out this morning. The Ford Foundation just announced this morning, and I'd urge you to look at this, that they're increasing their indirect cost rate to 20% as the floor, which also any flat rate is a little bit crazy because it's obviously all of you are doing different things. But Darren Walker in his letter this morning makes a big point of saying, you know, if we're serious about the kinds of organizations that are making a difference on the ground, you need to fund them in a way that enables them to do their work. It doesn't, and that there's differences between good overhead and bad overhead and so forth. So I think it's one of these technical things that's just this giant impediment to progress on results. And a lot of philanthropists do have arbitrary and really unintentionally unproductive limits to that, and a lot of nonprofits abide by it by not being clear on what it really takes to deliver results, and you just get this little kind of conspiracy of silence about what it really takes. So it's a great question. Hopefully the Darren Walker Ford Foundation, and it's their global portfolio around social justice organizations. So they're particularly kind of small organizations around the world that they're focused on this question on.
But can I just add, I think it's really important you know your costs, right? So overhead is just a label and you allocate, but I think if we just put more of an effort to know what things are costing and where your money is going, you will be able to be way more educated when you're telling the donor or who's asking you this is what it's being spent on, and if you can extend it to this is the impact it's having. So really work on the cost side, and I think this question will go away as we educate folks that...
The very first article that Bridgespan wrote 15 years ago was called Costs Are Cool. And we actually thought as a marketing gimmick that that might actually make it true. It didn't work. To Neera's point, I do think it is one of those, a basic starting point. Other questions, comments? Here's a microphone coming.
So, Neera's father, Seema's father, Deval's father-in-law, Dilip Nandi. And the question I have is, I'm noticing that there are a lot of people who are doing philanthropy work, not only in India, but other countries as well. But having grown up in India, the question I have is, there is a cultural issue that everybody faces over there. So if you want to change the girls, there is a cultural issue with the girls, how they've grown up, even if you want to do a washroom. Okay, now there is in India, like if it is a Brahmin, he has to go from, or she has to go from this side, or if she is some other caste, she has to go from there. So how do you really tackle the issue of cultural change?
this is like a hard audience. Like that, because these questions are tough. How do you?
I mean, I have a simple answer. I think really work with a nonprofit that understands it and is working in those communities, and they will know how to tackle these issues on the ground. Do not go yourselves. Would be the best way, because there are organizations that are community-based, so the community themselves have created organizations, or there's nonprofit leaders who are going into these communities. I would say reach out to them. Or partner. I mean, Peter talks about partnerships a lot.
Yeah. Any other thoughts on? I mean, it's a great question that connects to the kind of the, being connected to the ground. On things, did you have something, Peter?
I think it's recognizing it. It continually sort of surprises me that people will think about changing society in a particular way, and they'll come in and it's very, very forthright. So if I said, take the Catholics and Protestants in Northern Ireland. Northern Ireland is part of the United Kingdom. It's got 2.7 million people. It's tiny. 93% of the children either go to a Catholic school or they go to a Protestant school. Only 7% of the children in Northern Ireland, this is part of the United Kingdom. So you say, well, why is that? Just, you know, close the schools and make them do this and make them do that. And it's crazy because it's not facing up to the issues, whereas Atlantic has spent a lot of money where Catholic and Protestant schools are both effectively controlled by the church. The British government has effectively devolved policy for education as part of the United Kingdom, as part of the peace process. They gave the rights to Northern Ireland, but the Northern Ireland people then said, you've given us the right, we'll do it the way we want, so we'll divide it Catholics and Protestants. So if you don't get your mind around the cultural issues and then identify who the movers and the shakers are. So where are the points of leverage? And Atlantic's done a lot of work on this, but so that the point of leverage is the parent. Point of leverage is the child. I wish I could say the point of leverage for those that support the church, you know, forgive me, but the point of leverage is definitely not the Catholic and the Protestant churches, because they see their membership of their clubs to be sacrosanct. You know, they don't want to lose members. And, you know, we sit down and talk to the heads of churches and they say this, you know, it's great for you, you're from wherever I'm from on that day. And they're not interested in talking about it, so you may as well forget the church and get to the parents. And now the whole lobbying of that system in Northern Ireland, because the population is contracting, the number of schools that are needed are less. Now it's an economic argument where we're saying to both parties, share a school. And this is a big breakthrough. They share a school, but the kids wear different uniforms. Get it? Different uniforms. And they only have joint classes on Wednesday afternoon. But they're in the same building. So that's perceived as progress. So we're going to be there for a while, I think.
Let me ask about what can be learned from India back here. When several years ago, I was meeting with a guy on the East Coast named Desh Desponde, who does a lot of work in India, and I literally met him at a cocktail party. I'd heard about his philanthropy, and he came up to me and said, I've read some of your work on scale. I've done a lot of writing on scale. I'd love to talk to you. And Bridgespan's a nonprofit. I'm thinking, like, this is looking good. You know, Desh Desponde wants to talk. So I go up to his office, and he says, you know, I read your stuff on scale, and it's like, it's not really about scale at all. Which was not exactly the conversation I was aiming for. And I said, well, what do you mean? And he says, well, you have to go to India. Like this, you're writing about these things of like 1,000 kids, and next year we're gonna get to 1,100 kids, and the next year we're gonna get to 1,200 kids. He said, at Akshapatra, we're serving 1.3 million kids midday meals, or at Agustia, we're serving 5 million kids math programs. He said, if you care about scale, you need to go to India to learn about scale. And subsequently, I've been to India many, 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 many times. And he's right that there's a lot there. So I'm curious, what are the most important things folks in the United States or in other countries can learn from what is happening in India, in philanthropy, in the social sector?
I think the frugality of how things are run within the NGO is very telling. So the money goes a long way. So if you had a dollar to give and you were of Indian origin and you had a choice between your backyard here and giving it to India, I would say the money goes a lot further. Not that there isn't a great need here. There's a big digital divide and there's a big economic divide increasingly that Larry talked about when he spoke at the beginning. But that said, I think the money goes a lot further in India. You could support a lot of kids with a fairly small amount of money. But you have to find the right nonprofit and the right partner to work with. And the goals have to match. And I would say another thing, which is take a, frequently in philanthropy, that retail experience, sort of meeting the people that are benefiting by your philanthropy is very, very important because it actually gives you a sense of how you're actually making an impact on the ground. So if you never go there and you just write a check and all you see is a video once a year at the fundraiser, that's not a good way to experience your philanthropy. I think you need to actually be physically there, which gets you mentally engaged. And when you get mentally engaged, even if you don't have the time, at least be mentally engaged. But if you have the time and you can give a little bit of that time, it makes it even more meaningful to the NGO that you're supporting. And so I would pick one or two organizations that that you care about and work closely with them. And you could start small and then grow. But I think, like you said, scale is something you can achieve a lot of in India. There's a lot of need and there's lots of organizations. So you could choose which ones you want to work with and how. And I think you could see impact fairly quickly.
Yeah. Any other kind of lessons that transfer from India out?
So I think there are, I'm sure there's quite a few lessons, but something that jumped to my mind that actually doesn't transfer out, which might explain some of why we are able to achieve scale is not just because the magnitude of the problem is gigantic and our population is gigantic, but I think it's also that our government systems are broken. And so when you have basic rights and basic things like quality education or access to healthcare, these things that, you know, typically you want the government to be able to provide, and in many developed countries they do provide, although the quality is questionable. What the non-government organizations that are called nonprofits, we call them NGOs in India, are often providing services and products and the things to folks that the government system isn't. And so I think that in and of itself allows organizations to kind of get that scale fairly quickly, especially when they're leveraging the government system to be able to achieve that scale. I think something that is transferable that helps in India, and I feel that the US and more developed countries could use, is leveraging people from the community to deliver the intervention themselves. And if you look at Educate Girls or you look at other organizations here, when they bring people from the community and say, this is how you can help your community, I feel like some of that is so translatable here to the issues when working with police and law enforcement, where if you have community helping the community, I've seen that is what really has transformed many models in India.
There's a piece of research that's called How Organizations Change as They Grow. And sometimes it's called Evolution and Revolution. And when you look at organizations, and you certainly see many of them here, that grow very, very quickly, they're into this process of adaptation. They recognize, I'm not thinking about not-for-profits, I'm thinking about sort of technology, where they'll change the management styles to make sure that they can grow. You know, so you get to a point of like 100 people, it's management by touch, the founders know exactly what's going on, and then you're going to go into the next phase and you're going to need different skills, and to get those different skills you're going to bring in senior people, which means you've got to transfer some of the power, which isn't always easy. So when organizations go through these steps, you tend to get disturbances and sometimes, you know, negative repercussions. So I think in the commercial world, growth is seen as value. It's normally directly linked to sort of going public. It's directly linked to making a lot of money. So there's a big incentive to bring in the skills that you need and the venture capitalists will help you identify really talented people that will take you to the next phase and then take you to the next phase. So part of it's about the motivation, part of it's about the agents that help you do this. And in the philanthropic sector, that's not there. So you take something like Magic Bus, which is very unusual. It's a great organization. And Matthew recognized the need to bring someone in that would have those skills. And the guy is a professional manager. But you have to get to a certain size to do that. You have to be prepared to relinquish a certain amount of power to do that. You have to have the ambition to do it. You need to be able to attract the funders to do it. So the process is a lot more difficult, I think, to grow in the philanthropic sector than it is in commercial. It's easier to get your hands on the money.
Great. So let me wrap this up just to acknowledge we didn't come back to the second question that was first asked, but this afternoon there's a panel on impact investing and the role of markets in scaling change. So there'll be an hour on that people can dig into, because I think it's a great question about kind of how do you truly scale impact and what role do markets, impact investing, play in that, Just to close with kind of where Larry in some sense started us about the role of philanthropy in building a robust society, I think these the three kind of leaders that we have up here today, I think are wonderful examples of the kind of energy, creativity, pushing on the boundaries, hitting the questions and grappling with it, that's going to be critical to actually breaking through. And I know there's many in the audience that could be up here as well that are doing that, but I think it bodes incredibly well for the future of India and for the future of philanthropy that folks like this are pushing the boundary and pushing the thinking. So I'm just deeply grateful, and on all our behalf, thank you three for being here this morning.
Thank you.